One year there was a flu and we sold a hell of a lot of Vicks Vaporub during that flu. Unfortunately, this was at the time of Indira Gandhi and the license Raj. And what had we done? We had exceeded our capacity. Every company that time had a license. And we had a license capacity to produce only so many tons of Vicks. And we had produced almost 50% more. And sure enough, a summons arrived in Delhi. I mean, from Delhi. We were in Bombay company. And the summons was asking me to explain why we had broken the law. So I arrived there. And there was a three-year jail sentence for disobeying, for breaking the law. And so you can imagine this is a joint secretary sitting there. He wants to make an example of us. So he keeps me waiting for 2 hours outside his office. And then when I have 2 lawyers from Crawford Bailey on each side, and we are finally taken into his room, and he's reading the paper. He doesn't look, we've just sat down, he doesn't look at us, keeps reading the paper. And then I go like this to remind him that we are sitting there. And he looks at me and he says, "Kya? What do you want?" I said, "Sir, you have asked me here. So you tell me." And he says, no, kya kya hai? File nahi dekha humne." And I said, "Well, this is what happened. We produced a lot of Vicks. It was beyond our capacity, licensed capacity. And we thought we had done a good job because we kept the pharmacy shelves stocked during a pandemic and brought a lot of, relief to children and less anxiety for mothers during this epidemic." And he says, "Yes, but you've broken the law." I said, "Yes, that's true." And he says, you guys are all crooks in the business world, especially you multinational companies. We were an American multinational. He was a Marxist and a true believer in the license Raj. And he says, "Look, I'm sorry, you've broken the law. Now the law will take its own course." So there was no sympathy on his side. And the lawyers were shivering on both sides. And he said, jao, throwing us out of his office. And just as I was leaving, I turned around, I don't know what got into me, and I said, "Sir, what if this news goes out?" And it will, because we are an international company. It's not every day that you send an executive of a multinational company to jail anywhere in the world. And what do you think our country will look like when people read that here's a company that produced a product which was needed by millions of people and and the result of it is you put the guy in jail?" So he says, "Are you threatening me?" I said, "No, I'm just telling you, I'm not going to leak it out, but it will go out, the news will get out, and it will appear in the New York Times, Washington Post, or the papers in the world." And he frowned and he said, jao. Anyway, I had a number of sleepless nights after that, knowing when I'll be going to jail, but the government dropped the inquiry. Anyway, this is not so much about making a life that it's more to tell you what operating, how lucky you are, young people, that you are not operating in the licensed Raj. This is what it was like. It was a madness, lunacy. And just what they did 2 weeks ago in Delhi, by the way, they put computers under licensing. I don't know whether you know. Read the tomorrow's Times of India. I have written an article on the editorial page about it. But this is, we lived under that lunacy for all these years. Anyway, fast forward, at 37, I become the CEO of the company where I had started. And then that company is bought worldwide by Procter & Gamble. So we become Procter & Gamble India. And one fine day, I'm by now at the world headquarters. And there's a meeting, of a global meeting of the team that runs Pampers, a product that we make, P&G makes. And the news has just come that morning on the radio, as I heard it in the car coming to work, that India's economic reforms were in trouble. This is 1994. Narasimha Rao is under great attack by the left wing, by the left, especially the left of the Congress Party, and so there's a fear in the country that the reforms might be undone. And so I was thinking about that, and I said, "Oh my God." And when I'm at this Pampers meeting, I said, what the hell am I doing? Talking about Pampers in Africa and Asia and Europe and all that. I mean, good product. But here's history being undone in India, and what am I doing? Anyway, that's when I quit my job in the company. I came back. I then became a kind of cheerleader for the reforms. I started writing a column. I became a full-time writer. What I haven't told you is that in between, there were days when I used to ask myself, what am I doing, even earlier. I missed the intellectual life of the university. And so my father actually had said that, look, you have your weekends. Do something else over the weekend. And so I began to write over the weekends. In fact, one morning, I was 22 years old, and I said to myself that it must be a morning like this when Shakespeare sat down to write Hamlet, and I sat down to write my first play called Larin Sahab, which luckily won a big prize, and then it was performed, and then it also was done by BBC and all that. So I sort of started a second career on the weekend, and I had a second play called Meera, based on Meerabai, where the producers in New York converted Meera bhajans to rock music, became a rock musical, and did well in New York. So I had this second career which had got started. So when I quit my corporate life, I could fall back on something that I'd written a novel. I see those books are there, the plays and the novel also at the back. And the fact is that I had almost prepared myself for a second career, and that was writing. And luckily I had the confidence because the plays had done well, the novel A Fine Family had done well, and anyway, that was my story. I'm just checking the time to see whether we have time for the two other stories. But the lesson, frankly, from this story, what is this story that I have quickly told you before I tell you the other stories?
Somebody has to go, where is he gone?
Right. The one is that that my life had this double theme, thanks to my mother and my father. I had a father who had thought differently and encouraged me to take some risks in life and never really told me, in fact told my mother not to be too obsessed with making a life. So I had a making a life, making a living, making a life. And so I had made a living, and I had made a living to the point where we had a nest egg. When I was 50, I quit. We had a nest egg so that we could live. My wife was horrified that the monthly checks would not come anymore. And so she wasn't sure whether this was a good decision, but she was a good sport. And so we came back to India. So the other point here, or maybe, you know, before I draw the lessons of that I'm going to draw, let me move quickly to the second story, because then I'll integrate the whole business. So the second story is a person, Kamble made his life at his job. In other words, I think from the day that he arrived, you could tell that he was different. He didn't know English, but he had a fascination for anything that he did not understand, like technology. First day he spotted the tea making and coffee making machine in our office. And he got so fascinated, he learned to make it. And then because he had made coffee and tea, he would go and offer it to people. So while he was doing his security round, he came for the evening shift. He came at 5:30 in the evenings when the office closed and people stayed on. And to those who stayed on, he was experimenting with, he was like a child who had found a toy. Next day, he found the telex machine. Those days, we sent telexes to each other. And he didn't know English, but he was fascinated with this, how this telex machine worked, so that he then taught himself English. He was a night shift guard. So in daytime, he took a course in English. And after 6 weeks to a month or so, he had learned some English. And he started sending telex messages. First he sent telex messages to himself to make sure. And then he was sending these telex messages. And so just like, he was like a child. You know what a child does? When it's raining, all the adults will carry an umbrella and there's a puddle on the road and the adults will carefully go around the puddle. Child goes and jumps into the puddle to see what it feels like. Well, that's what Kamble was, that he had this tremendous curiosity, but also he loved his job. I think he would have paid us to come to work every day if it came to that. So they had these, so one was he loved his job. Third, he was hungry. Hungry for some, you know, to do something. So, the fourth quality about him was a sense of basic integrity. I mean, he found one day, one of the managers, senior managers, had dropped his wallet outside the men's room. And It had a lot of money in it. And so he comes to me and he says, Saab, ye to bahut paisa hai isme. And he says, ki maine dekha hai andar, ye ID hai uska manager ka. To usko to pareshani hogi ki paisa itna kho diya. So he said, he gave me the keys of the office. And he said, now you be the security guard for 1 hour. I'll go to Bandra and I will deliver this in a taxi. And he says, by the way, give me 10 rupees. Those days, 10 rupees was enough to get a taxi. And so I gave him 10 chips and he went. And it was a lot of money because this manager was putting an advance for a flat. So it was like lakhs of rupees were in that. And he had gone to the bank to draw the money out to pay the advance. And the seller was coming right that evening. So I arrived, I mean, Kamble arrived just a few minutes before the seller came in. And you can't imagine the relief that the husband and wife had when they saw Kamble with the wallet. But the other thing that he told them, don't tell anyone that I delivered this wallet. And he also told me, ki batana nahi kisi ko. And why? Because I think he never wanted to sort of, he had a modesty, a basic self-effacing modesty. He didn't want people to think, ah, Kamble ne ye kiya hai. In other words, he's the type of person, we all of us meet this sort of, it's very rare, by the way, we meet a person who doesn't care who gets the credit. You know, he works in a team, that's such a person, she works in a team, but doesn't really want a credit. Anyway, a few months later, I think Kamble had been there for about 5-6 months, and he'd already established a formidable reputation for, if anything was in the evening shift, if you needed anything, you said, ask Kamble. He would, by then he was able also, he knew how to do that. You know, we had a EPBX. I mean, those days we used to have a big, huge, you know, you put wires in to get telephone calls connected, so he was answering phones. So our telephone operator during the day shift was going to have a baby. So she was going on maternity leave for a few months. So Kamble went to the head of personnel and he said to him, look, give me a chance. I'm tired of working at night. I'll be your temporary telephone operator until she comes back, and then I'll go back to my job. And that guy says, Kamble, we are a multinational company. We get calls from around the world. You don't know English. How can we give you this job? Bichara Kamble, he goes off with a long face, but I hear through the grapevine about what Kamble has wanted. And so I told the personnel guy, I said, look, give him a chance. Let's try him out for a few days, have a backup ready. And if he doesn't work out, theek hai, we'll give the job to someone else. So the personnel guy reluctantly agrees. And so next morning I'm seeing Kamble sitting at the booth, telephone booth hota tha. And you know, with all these wires that were you had to push in. And after 2 days, the lawyer, company's lawyer, Crawford Bailey, Mr. Shah, came in. And he asked me, by the way, Gurcharan, do you have a new EPBX system? I said, no. He says, well, you know, before, your phones used to ring 4-5 times before it was answered. And now it's promptly picked up on the second ring. So what is your, what's the secret? And I said, Kamble. And so I asked Kamble after Mr. Shah left. I was, you know, when I was going home in the evening, I said, Kamble, why do you answer the phone so quickly? And he gave me an answer that devastated me. He said, there may be a customer on the other side, Amrutanjan or somebody, you know, Halls or whatever product our competitor, we were competing against. He says, I don't want you to lose an order. I bet you our head of marketing couldn't have answered that question so well. So this is what Kamble was like. He instinctively understood who paid his salary. It was the customer. He had done no MBA, nothing, but instinctively the guy. Anyway, I could go on. All I can tell you is that this, the company recognized that they had somebody unusual. And so he kept getting promoted. Every few years he'd get promoted until he retired as a director of the company.
हॅलो टोटल अजूनपर्यंत 15 भुरगीं शेणल्या सर हय सर चडशी 7 ते 10 वर्सां आं शाळेंत सोडल्यो तुमी
शाळेन चे शाळा आसतना ती वचना सर
आनी आतां तर सुटी पडल्या तुमी आनी कितें साय
सर सुटी पडल्या आतां तुमी आनी कितें सर ना सॉरी सर सॉरी सर ना हय तुमी म्हणटाले हांव वचून पळयतां आतां इतली बरी शाळा चोरानो म्हजे कडेन खेळटा गोवा पुलिसा कडेन
सॉरी काका
सॉरी सॉरी बी कांय ना खंय आसा ती बाकीची भुरगीं चला या आतां घरा अरे भुरगीं पयलीं शाळेन वचपाक रडटाली आतां घरा वचपाक रडटा हो कसलो रे चमत्कार
चमत्कार न्ही आमचो गोंय सरकार
अरे गांवांत गांवांत जर अश्यो सुंदर शाळा जाल्यो जाल्यार भुरग्यांच्या शिक्षणा बद्दल भिवपाची गरज ना
भिवपाची तूं आतां आमकां घरा वचपाची गरज ना
नव्या तमाचे सर्त उतराचे हे आमचे सरकार सवंताच्या खाला सपना जाता साकार नव्या तमाचे सेर तुतराचे हे आमचे सरकार सवंताच्या खाला सपना जाता साकार गोयाचो फुलारे फुडार खोशी आसा रे गोयकार युपाची काय गरज ना
आता
दरेक गोयकाराचो आधार, डॉक्टर प्रमोद सावंताचे गोय सरकार.